Enregistré. Ok, donc là c'est bon, ça c'est
Okay,
parti.
thank you. So I will present you some insight of statistics and large atomic simulation database for the microstructure modeling of RPV steels under radiation. So this work is done between joint work between EDF and University of Lille in the framework of a joint lab, which is EM2VM, where there is also the JPM laboratory at University of Rouen. Next.
Next.
Next. So the motivation is the thermal aging and neutron irradiation of structural materials of nuclear reactor. The temperature is 200 degrees C, and we want to know the aging of these materials for 40, 60 years and perhaps more. And for that, so there is the joint lab I just mentioned, and there is also a material aging institute that has been built at EDF in collaboration with some other utilities worldwide. For the under radiation, you have in steels, you have formation of solute cluster, which contribute to the hardening of the materials and also to the increase of the brittle to ductile transition. And there is also some defect created in the radiation. For in terms of materials, so today I will focus on RPV steels, which is ferritic steels, but we are also interested in austenitic steels, austenoferritic steels, and we are also looking at some kind of new alloy like high entropy alloy or concentrated alloy. And next.
Voilà.
So for that, we have developed a multi-scale modeling approach. With so here I will stop today at the microstructure, not plasticity and not mechanical property, but there is a ab initio DFT calculation to have accurate energetics of defect, and there is a classical mechanics, and there is a kinetic Monte Carlo, and also some red theory. And in front of that, there is a large effort also for the experimental validation at the small scale, in particular with tomographic atom probe, positron annihilation, small angle neutron scattering, and also TEM. Next. So for that, the question is between phenomena and method, because we want to go to a long term and big component of several hundred of tons. And at the beginning, the interaction of the neutron with the steel is producing damage, which is cascade, displacement cascade, which is the time scale is a few picoseconds. So for that, we have to upload this multi-scale modeling strategy, and we have the formation of this damage, and after what is the main point to have the evolution of this damage under irradiation and with time, it's kinetic Monte Carlo, or also red theory. Next. So for that, we are modeling this complex chemistry as we want to be the closest as possible as a real steel, and also point defect. Point defect is here, so it's a vacancy. There is vacancy, of course, but also there is interstitials. And that makes things quite complicated. And we have under radiation, the concentration of both of these effects is really several of the magnitude more than for thermal aging. And so for that, the two main points is to have to build some cohesive model for the kinetic Monte Carlo, and also to have a very good characteristic of the primary damage. And as with this point defect, there is strong interaction with solute that makes many possibility of interaction, and the reason why we have all these atomic calculation. Next. So for the Monte Carlo, kinetic Monte Carlo, we have two approaches. We have the atomic approach, where we consider each defect, each atom, each solute, and we consider the jump of each of these defects. And after, we have the object kinetic Monte Carlo, where we have it's a kind of coarse grain of atomic Monte Carlo. Well, if you have three vacancies, for example, you consider it as a single object where you have two possibilities, which is a mobility of this object or emission of this object. And as we have also solutes, so we need all these data, as I say. And we have also, as atomic Monte Carlo is quite long, even object in some time, so we are also trying to couple both of them in order to boost the calculation. Next. So just to remind you the method for, so there is also an event kinetic Monte Carlo, but I will consider the OKMC object, where you have all the different jump, so it's a migration close to the atomic distance of the different mobile defect. And on the right side, you have different objects, so we can have big object or small object, and all this, and when they are close together, there is some reaction. Next. So after for this reaction, we have many possibilities. V stands for vacancy, and you have SIA for self-interstitials, and also we can be have FIA, which is foreign interstitial atom. So that can be carbon, but carbon is not so so present, but that can be in some case helium that you have under neutron reaction. And we have to characterize all these reactions, and we have S at the bottom right, which is a solute atom that has to be considered, that makes many, many mechanisms to know what is the rate of this different reaction. Next. So first of all, I will go to primary damage, which is due to the neutron interaction, so which is the kinetic transfer to the atoms. For that, it is done by molecular dynamics, which is the right method because this is something which lasts for a few 10 of picoseconds. And but 10 picoseconds for a classical MD is a very short time. But as we have a very high energy, so the atoms is going very fast, and we need to have very small time step. And it is a phenomena which is on a few 10 of nanometers, so it is up to few million of atoms in the box, which is quite. And for statistical analysis, so we need statistical analysis to know what are there can be some kind of rare events and some variability. I will show just next. And for that represent billion of core errors of CPU time, because one cascade can take from 1 hour to several thousand of hours. So next. So here it's an illustration at the bottom. You have six different cascades with the same condition, but just the variability, it's just the initial random velocity of the atoms, because it's done in temperature, and that generates different kind of structure of defect. And in this defect, which is at the center, so you have the defect, and you have you can have some dislocation loops that are generated within that. And so for that, we need cohesive model, and we are making some work, large work, in order to validate and to assess this potential, and that we develop a methodology based on some DFT calculation to evaluate this defect, because it's you have as you have lots of energy, you have your atoms which are close, much closer than to equilibrium distance, and there is this you have some kind of repulsion, and this repulsion will have some strong impact on the damage produced. Next. So it's an illustration with many statistics. With so we have in the label 1 to 5, it's the energy up to 160. It's the energy of the pKa of the energy transfer from the neutron in kilo electron volt, and you have the size distribution of the defect produced, and so it's log scale, huh? And you see that for high energy cascade that that occur with some of the neutron interactions. You can generate defect, so in few 10 of picoseconds, which is defect of more than 100. So more than 100 size, it corresponds to that can correspond to a loop, a dislocation loop of typically 1 to about 2 nanometer size. So which is quite important, because as you generate that, you have a kind of you have not a kind of incubation time and so on to have the agglomeration of defect to generate that, and that has an impact on the microstructure evolution. Next it's an illustration of the, you have a kind of zoology of defect produced. So you have some loops, and which is in you have in red, in green, sorry, it's a 111 loop, and you have also some 11100 vacancy loop in some case, which has in purple. And after, for the small defect in particular, small self-interstitial cluster, you have some complex non-parallel configuration that is quite also important, because what is important is to know what are their mobility to contribute to the annihilation or to the production of larger defects. Next. Okay, so now I will go to the evolution, microstructure evolution. And so for that, there is all the elementary mechanism, which is formation energy, migration energy. And after, there is all the interaction of defect and solutes. So there is point defect, which is quite easy, because not so much. But after, with all the defect clusters that are considered, that make some kind of combinatorial explosion, if you want to consider the main solute in RPV steel. And the one which are quite important for the microstructure evolution is copper, nickel, manganese, silicon, and phosphorus. And so from this all this DFT calculation, there is some need to build some kind of meta model to export this data in order to have the evolution of the system. Next. So here it's some of the different interstitial clusters that you can have. So interstitial means self-interstitials, and when they are you can have two different configurations. And after, when you have several ones, you can have many different possibilities. So they are not all the lowest. There is only one which is the lowest energy. But during the course of this non-Tegram process of formation of the displacement cascade and the defect at the end, all these different configurations can be present. And there is some interaction with solutes. And after, at some point, there is some larger one, non-parallel configuration, C15 cluster, which is the lava phase. And after, you have the loop, 111 loop. So I will just, after, next, illustrate the calculation of this solute interaction with different position of the loop. So from the left, it is at the center of the loop, and from the right, it is on the outside the loop. So this is an interstitial loop. So in fact, if the loop is large enough, the loop corresponds to edge dislocation. And for that, there is no really reliable intermediate potential. So we are doing that by DFT. So it is DFT in iron with 1,500 atoms. And so it is quite a heavy calculation. And you can see that the most interaction, the largest interaction at close to the border of the loop, so which corresponds somehow to the core of the edge dislocation segment that form the loop. So next. So from this data, first of all, a simple analysis is to estimate what is the segregation with this kind of segregation energy, what can be the enrichment ratio that we can have. So which is quite potentially quite high. Next. So after Fortis, I think Monte Carlo. So there is different approach that we have used. There is the off lattice with VM potential with CAIRT developed by Normand Mousseau in Canada. And so we have applied that for iron carbon to analyze the mechanism of carbon interaction with the loop and the possibility, in fact, of the carbon to more or less migrate within the core of the loop. But after to speed up the calculation to see microstructure evolution, so we have to go to rigid lattice and with pair interaction, cluster expansion. And also we try to develop some kind of model based on the physics we observe, because if you consider triplet, quadruplet, and so on, when you have lots of solute, that makes several hundred of parameters to determine. So we can calculate this by DFT. But at first, there is a question: if you stop to quadruplet, for example, what about a cluster of five solutes which are different? Are you good to describe them? It's not so obvious. So for that, and there is also, I will not illustrate that today, but to use some of DFT data on simple system to use artificial neural network in order to predict the property. But in fact, even for that, with several tens of billion of CPU errors in a binary system, you have you can get a few thousands of migration energy for different environments. But it's lots of calculation, but for neural network, it's just the limit to be able to describe the system. So next. So here it's an illustration of the cluster which are formed under, sorry, it's an illustration not under radiation, but under thermal aging. And you have some atom probe results, which is what is written Stiemann 2012, and which is a thermal aging of 90,000 hours, which is quite long thermal aging around 300 degrees C. And this is the different cluster that we get from modeling. And in fact, what we develop with the new, there is results with the flow chart. On the right, it is just a pair model. And after there is CDP, which is the advanced model we develop with, in fact, not so much parameter. There is about 20 to 30 parameter, which is not so much for to describe a system with six solute. And we have a quite good prediction of the composition of this cluster. So next. So now it's the use of the DFT data I show you about the interaction of solute with loops that has been used in order to model the mobility of the loop, which has been used in object in Monte Carlo. And so you see that that allow to predict the density of loop form and compare that to some TM measurement. And in that sense, you are able to see the difference, to simulate the difference between a model iron carbon alloy and iron manganese nickel alloy, which is quite quite important. And after for the work is to assess that for a much more complex alloy with the different elements. So next. Yeah, so just it's a kind of summary of the modeling of RPV that we are doing from the atomic so many DFT calculations to know what are the mechanisms and to characterize them properly, the displacement cascade, and after the evolution of the microstructure by both atomic in Monte Carlo and object in Monte Carlo, and after interaction with dislocation dynamics to develop some hardening model and so on, and also to have with some colleagues to develop some constitutive law for irradiated sticks. And so next, it's just to finish Another point, which is thermal edging. Thermal edging is also important for the case of cast authentic stainless steel for the elbow of primary coolant. So again, it's the question of the edging of this alloy for 60 years and so on. And so we have there is a TDF. We have different elbow and from different manufacturer, and with sometimes some difference of composition. And the question is what is the edging of these materials, and what is the stability of the precipitate? So you have a spinodal decomposition, and you have also formation of some manganese, nickel, silicon, and sometimes molybdenum rich cluster, which is close to G phase. And so for that, you have many atom probe. We are doing some atom probe, and after to know the stability of that by some heat treatment at higher temperature, like 500 or 550 degrees C, we see what is the stability of this alloy. And so in terms of modeling, in fact, we had a collaboration with Matcalc, with Ernst, and so we did some thermodynamic calculation with Matcalc, and the database, kind of specific database for RRPV alloy, has been improved thanks to some DFT calculations. So and here it's not a hundred or thousand of DFT calculation, but just a few calculations of some phase, in particular some G phase. And that allows to see that when you have the in terms of temperature, the molybdenum is shown to slow down the resonation of the microstructure, which is in agreement with the experimental results. And furthermore, with the chart, we have the comparison of the composition of the experimental cluster by atom probe and the calculation with Matcalc, and we have some good agreement on this cluster, and so some kind of good sensitivity in terms of the alloy initial alloy composition. So next, it's just close to finish. So with this multi-scale modeling, we have between many points. There is the point of the high throughput database, and that has pointed out today. But after, there is a problem of that we have to deal with. We have the complexity. And so the multi-scale problem with the length scale and time scale, but also question about uncertainty statistics, and also in terms of accuracy, how to go from DFT calculation to upper scale model. And next, for that there is an important point, which is a kind of coarse graining of the elemental mechanism that we can get from DFT, issue about sensitivity analysis. And after, there is as we try to put as much physics as we can in this model, the prediction of the microstructure evolution as function of composition. So that can be also important for high entropy alloy, and to be dependent of the condition in terms of temperature, aging condition, solicitation, environment. And so in terms of database, that makes lots of calculation, but the point is that the cost of one calculation is very high, and it's we can have a thousand of calculation, but billion of CPU errors. That's quite important. And so challenge for that, there is challenge and for analysis of that in terms of descriptor. Dependent of local environment for defect configuration, so there is some colleagues working on that. It's not so always so easy, but it's progress. And in terms also of transferability, and all that is used to build some physics based model for the nuclear materials under aging. And next, just to finish, to thanks. Thanks the different collaboration we have on this work, and also the different collaborative European project that has been involved in that for 20 years now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.